It was 25 years ago, a sunny day in Dallas. A few seconds of violence that changed America forever. John F. Kennedy killed by an assassin's bullet. The government claims Lee Harvey Oswald shot Kennedy without help. Other experts cry cover-up. They have evidence of a plot. I'm Edwin Newman. Who killed Camelot? You'll find out the theories when you join me for a two-hour 25th anniversary special on many of these PIA radio network stations.
Okay, 15 seconds.
You, John Fitzgerald Kennedy, do solemnly swear.
I, John Fitzgerald Kennedy, do solemnly swear.
That you will faithfully execute the office of President of the United States.
That I will faithfully execute the office of President of the United States.
And will, to the best of your ability.
And will, to the best of my ability.
Preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution of the United States.
Preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution of the United States.
So help you God.
So help me God.
And so, my fellow Americans, ask not what your country can do for you, ask what you can do for your country.
It appears as though something has happened in the motorcade group. There has been a shooting. I repeat, a shooting in the motorcade in the downtown area. The president's car is now going past me. Now traveling at a very high rate of speed, Secret Service men standing up in the limousine. They are armed with submachine guns. You see, this is Kennedy's pink suit. There's a Secret Service man, spread eagle, over the top of the car. At this point, it looks as though it could have been one or two or even all of the people within the car may have been the victims, may have been struck by shots. We don't know.
Here is a flash from Dallas. Two priests who were with President Kennedy say he is dead of bullet wounds suffered in the assassination attempt today. I will repeat with the greatest regret this flash. Two priests who were with President Kennedy say he has died of bullet wounds.
I believe that the evidence strongly suggests that Oswald was implicated in the conspiracy in some fashion. I don't believe that there is credible, overwhelming evidence that he did the shooting that day.
I eventually came to the conclusion that Oswald did kill President Kennedy, and that he had rather complicated motives for that, but that he was guilty and that he very likely did not have any help in it.
What I'm saying is that the mafia murdered John Kennedy. It is a historical fact. It was a straight mob hit.
If you take those photographs that do relate to John F. Kennedy's murder and examine them, what you find is that everyone that's in the evidentiary base printed in the Warren Commission report has been tainted, altered, or changed to fit the predetermined official thesis that Lee Harvey Oswald murdered the president. I don't think the murder will ever be solved. Most murders never are, but I don't think this one will be.
Each evening, from December to December, before you drift to sleep upon your cot, think back on all the tales that you remember of Camelot. Ask every person if he's heard the story, and tell it strong and clear if he has not, that once there was a fleeting wisp of glory called Camelot.
The murder of John Fitzgerald Kennedy, 35th President of the United States. It happened on a sunny Dallas, Texas afternoon in the full view of hundreds of people. There were motion pictures taken of the crime and numerous photographs. Yet today, 25 years later, there are more questions about who killed the president and why this was allowed to happen than there were then.
I'm
This is Edwin Newman. Come along with me during the next 2 hours as the PIA radio network asks the questions and explores the paths down which those questions lead. All this and more when we look at the JFK conflict. Was President Kennedy in Dallas on that November afternoon? It was far from a pleasure trip. The answer was politics. This was not Camelot's most shining moment. In 1963, the United States was just beginning to recover from an unsuccessful entanglement with Cuba. The Bay of Pigs incident had profoundly embarrassed the Kennedy administration. And the lack of success against the Castro regime had the far right in an uproar.
This administration intends to be candid about its errors. For as a wise man once said, an error doesn't become a mistake until you refuse to correct it. We intend to accept full responsibility for our errors, and we expect you to point them out when we miss them.
Texas had become a hot spot in the nation's political climate. Just the week before, Kennedy's United Nations ambassador, Adlai Stevenson, had been to the Lone Star State and had narrowly avoided a beating at the hands of an angry mob. Couple these facts with Kennedy's own personal dislike of his vice president, Texas Lyndon Johnson, and the need to patch up a rift with that state before the presidential election the following year. The trip to Texas was, therefore, personally distasteful, but politically unavoidable. At 12:30, the president's motorcade had just traveled past the Texas Book Depository building when the shots began to ring out. Moments later, the crime of the century would be complete, the president dead. Within hours, a man had been arrested, a man who would bear the public blame for the murder of John Kennedy, and who himself had less than 2 days to wait before his own murder. Lee Harvey Oswald.
Did you call the president?
No, I've not been charged with that. In fact, nobody has said that to me yet. The first thing I heard about was when the newspaper reporters in the hall asked me that question.
The official government version of who killed John Kennedy is Oswald. But did he really do it? Many researchers think not. There are widely varying theories, and many of them have to do with just who Lee Harvey Oswald really was. Robert Sam Anson is a journalist who extensively researched Oswald. He is the author of the book, They've Killed the President.
Well, there are some who say that Oswald was an agent of Fidel Castro, others who say that Oswald was an agent of the Soviet Union, still others who say that Oswald was an agent of U.S. intelligence. There have been theories that Oswald was implicated by the intentional use of a lookalike in the years or in the weeks and months immediately leading up to the assassination. There are even theories that Oswald did not go to the Soviet Union, but there was someone in the Soviet Union who was taking his place. There are a whole range of theories about Lee Harvey Oswald, who remains one of history's most fascinating and enigmatic characters.
Enigmatic, yes. Innocent? Of the shooting? Maybe. Of playing a role in the assassination? No. Ask three different assassination experts and you'll get four different opinions of who plotted Kennedy's death. Some put the blame on our own government, on the FBI or the Central Intelligence Agency. Others finger organized crime. Still others insist it was Fidel Castro, his agents, or Cuban sympathizers. In each of these theories, there is one common thread, Lee Harvey Oswald. Anson believes that Oswald was a man with CIA connections. He was, after all, a former member of the American military. He defected to the Soviet Union, where he took a wife, and returned to the United States after initially having been refused an exit visa from the Soviet Union. But how did he get out?
He was able to do that, I think, only with the assistance of U.S. intelligence. If his name were anything other but Lee Harvey Oswald, you would take a look at his remarkable career and conclude that, of course, he was an agent.
Let's take a moment for some Oswald history. He enlisted in the Marines at age 17 and ended up based in Atsugi, Japan, a location where military intelligence had a foothold. Without finishing his enlistment, he was granted an early discharge because his mother was supposedly very ill. As it turned out, she was not. Oswald spent less than a week at home, then took off for the Soviet Union, walked into the American Embassy in Moscow, turned in his passport, and claimed communism to be his ideology of choice. Professor Philip H. Melanson of the Political Science Department at Southeastern Massachusetts University believes that Oswald had some connection to the government as an agent of either the CIA or some other spy organization.
I think the main thrust of my analysis of Oswald is that regardless of whatever his role in President Kennedy's assassination, he remains and was the most mysterious and complex of all American assassins, alleged or real, and that there seems no doubt in my mind that he was in some capacity an agent of the United States government, certainly when he went to Russia as a defector, and quite probably in his domestic political activities when he returned.
So does that settle it? Does that make Lee Harvey Oswald an agent of the United States government beyond a reasonable doubt? You might think so, until you hear Dan Moldea. As a specialist in organized crime and author of such works as The Hoffa Wars and Who Killed Bobby Kennedy, Moldea says it was a connection with Carlos Marcello, head of the New Orleans underworld, that got Oswald into a presidential assassination plot.
In fact, Oswald had numerous ties to organized crime people. His guardian while he was growing up was Charlie Dutz Murat, M-U-R-A-T. Murat was heading Marcello's gambling operations down in New Orleans and in Louisiana. He was a major cog in the Marcello operation. He was also an associate of David Ferry, and David Ferry was the private investigator, the personal pilot to Carlos Marcello down in New Orleans. When Marcello was deported by Bobby Kennedy right around the time of the Bay of Pigs invasion to Guatemala, when he returned illegally back into this country, it was Ferry who was piloting that plane to bring him back into the country.
So a reasonable case can be made that Oswald had connections with either our government or organized crime. The question surrounding Oswald would be greatly simplified if these were the only possibilities. But the speculation does not end there. Among all the experts, Gene Davison, author of Oswald's Game, is part of a very small minority of researchers who believe the official version that Lee Harvey Oswald was a lone nut gunman. She contends that he was a man whose sympathies with Castro's Cuba led him to take it into his head to kill the president, and that he acted on that impulse alone.
One of the things that I found in my investigation was the motive that I believe inspired him, at least consciously. I think it was a political motive. He was a great admirer of Fidel Castro's, and as I indicated before, his political philosophy was very much entwined with his emotional makeup. He was very fervent about these political beliefs. And he learned that the CIA, or the American government, was making attempts on Castro's life. And as a result, I believe that he retaliated in Dallas.
Oswald, either intentionally or out of his own gullibility, has left a series of crisscrossing paths and a contradictory paper trail that make his true personality and philosophy impossible to puzzle out. His actions and writing show him to be a master of misdirection, a Marine one minute and a defector the next, pro-Castro and anti-Castro with apparently equal vehemence and vigor, cunning dead-aim assassin and bumbling inept fall guy. Who was Lee Harvey Oswald? Maybe the question was put best by Robert Sam Anson in his book, They've Killed the President, where he says,
maybe the best way for me to sum up the complexity of Lee Harvey Oswald is to read a brief passage from my book about Oswald. Maybe the problem with understanding Oswald is that we think we know him so well, so ignore his name and then consider the facts. A man who works at a CIA base, has his records altered by the military, defects to Russia with no money, takes a plane when no planes are available, marries the niece of a high-ranking Soviet official, slips across the Iron Curtain without leaving a trace, threatens espionage and is not arrested, lives in a community infiltrated by intelligence agents, befriends a former spy, is seen in close contact with two intelligence agents, makes travel arrangements in the company of an employee of a CIA, uses an alias, keeps an office in a building with other agents, eludes detection by surveillance devices, gets a passport when one should be denied, and is finally shot down in a room crowded with police by a former informer for the nation's chief investigative agency. Absorb these things, and then imagine that the man they happen to is named John Smith. Who do you think he is?
No matter who Lee Harvey Oswald was, the question remains, what role did he have in the assassination? For researchers like Jean Davison, the answer is simple. Since she believes Oswald was a lone gunman, there are no loose ends. But for nearly everyone else, there are nagging, unanswered questions. The mystery begins at the Texas Book Depository, a building on the Kennedy motorcade route and the alleged site of the assassin's nest. Oswald was employed as a laborer at the book depository and had come to work as usual that day. From this point, the scenario shifts and shades depending on which expert you listen to. According to the government, Oswald entered the Texas Book Depository carrying a brown paper bag under his arm, a bag containing an unassembled rifle, the Italian rifle he would use to murder the president.
We know that Oswald had possession of that rifle because we have him photographed with it, and we have his wife saying that it was, quote, fateful rifle of Lee Oswald.
From there, the government declares he took his position in the window at the time the motorcade was to pass. After squeezing off three shots, Oswald calmly mingled with a panic-stricken crowd in the book depository lobby. He then left the building and boarded a public bus to make his escape. He was captured less than 2 hours later in a movie theater after shooting and killing a Dallas police officer. That is the version of the events in Dallas that day as accepted by the Warren Commission. It was expected to be the answer to quiet America's alarm, but did it?
Without any doubt, he's the killer. The law says beyond a reasonable doubt and to a moral certainty, which there's no question that he was the killer of President Kennedy.
Back with the JFK conflict after this. KNX Los Angeles.
Eisenhower and I share the grief that Mrs. Kennedy must now feel. And we send to her our prayerful thoughts and sympathetic sentiments in this hour.
Welcome back. I'm Edwin Newman. Almost from the beginning, independent investigators began poking holes in the official story. Sylvia Marr is one of the most well-respected investigators of the Kennedy assassination and wrote the book Accessories After the Fact. She says that the story of how Oswald committed the murder and then escaped just does not hold water.
I've used the classical three questions. Did he have motive? Did he have means? And did he have opportunity? On motive, even the commission could not arrive at any motive, and that remained moot. On the question of means, it required the highest degree of marksmanship, at least a rating of master marksman. Oswald was very poor shot, as his own brother said. He couldn't hit the side of a barn. Furthermore, you would need a very good weapon to achieve the kind of shooting that was achieved when the president was assassinated, hit right in the head, fatally, so that he was virtually dead on the spot. The weapon that Oswald supposedly had, although to my mind it has never been successfully placed in his possession by credible witnesses, that weapon was a cheap old Italian rifle that sold for $12.95 with a defective scope. So I don't believe he had the means. As far as opportunity goes, and I think this is a very, very strong point, Oswald was encountered in the second floor lunchroom of the book depository building a little over 1 minute after the shooting. He was standing calmly, drinking a Coca-Cola, which meant that he had to have time to get across the sixth floor, hide a weapon, wedge it in behind some cartons, run down four flights of stairs, get a coin out, insert it in the machine, and get his Coca-Cola, and be standing there calmly drinking the Coca-Cola when he was intercepted by a policeman together with the manager of the depository, Mr. Roy Truly. The policeman actually poked his gun into Oswald's middle, and Oswald simply looked rather surprised, and Mr. Truly, the superintendent, said, this man works here, it's okay. Oswald then meandered across the floor and out the front door, where he mingled with the crowd for a while. He made no attempt to escape.
Dr. David Rohn, author and head of the Assassination Archives at the University of Wisconsin at Stevens Point, has found through his examination of the Warren Commission report that by the commission's own evidence, Oswald could not have brought a gun into the Texas Book Depository.
They have only one witness who testifies that Lee Harvey Oswald carried this rifle that they alleged was used to murder President Kennedy into the Texas School Book Depository that morning. That man is Jack Doherty. Jack Doherty's job as an employee of the Texas School Book Depository was to come early to work around 7 o'clock and sit at a desk, a table actually, and watch every employee enter the building through the employee's entrance. Jack Doherty testified that Lee Harvey Oswald entered empty-handed, and they pushed him again, said he carried nothing in his hand. He said, that's right, nothing. And that is footnoted in the Warren Commission report. It footnotes to what? To the statement that Lee Harvey Oswald carried a rifle into the Texas School Book Depository, when the reverse is true. There's no evidence at all that he carried that rifle into the Texas School Book Depository, nor can they produce any.
Which, along with other bits of information, leads him to conclude that Oswald is innocent of the murder.
I really don't know what the situation is about. Nobody has told me anything. Murdering a policeman. I know nothing more than that, and I do request for someone to come forward to give me a legal assistance.
First point, Lee Harvey Oswald had nothing to do with the murder of John F. Kennedy, nor can any credible evidence be put forward to support Oswald as the assassin. And all credible evidence that has been put forth, or all allegedly credible evidence, is easily torn to the shreds of falsehood that it is. Second, it requires more than one gunman to perform what happened to John Kennedy that day. Three, you have other evidence to sustain a conspiracy.
We will talk more about a conspiracy and Oswald's possible connection to it in a moment. The JFK conflict returns right after this. The JFK conflict continues on the PIA radio network. I'm Edwin Newman. Understanding who Oswald was is nearly impossible. As Anson has said, he's one of history's most baffling characters. But there are some established facts. Researcher Gene Davison says that long before he became known to every American, Oswald's name popped up again and again in police records. He was first picked up for truancy in New York City at age 13. At that time, psychiatrists determined that he was having violent fantasies. Those tendencies led doctors to conclude that Oswald, though not insane, was a sociopath. Davison says his lack of social skills, coupled with his paranoid tendencies, were the reasons he embraced communism and the Soviet Union, not that he had affiliations with military intelligence.
He planned the defection for many months before he got out of the Marines, and he was very secretive about it, and he was very cunning about the plans that he made. He even tried to pretend that he was going to go to a university over there because he was a little paranoid that someone might try to stop him from going to the Soviet Union. And he did get into the Soviet Union. The Russians didn't want him to stay there. They tried to tell him to go home, and he made it difficult for the Russians to refuse him because when they told him that he would have to leave the country, he slashed his wrist, so he was taken to the hospital. Eventually, they did let him stay. They sent him off to Minsk, which was probably not a place he wanted to stay at. And after a while, living there for a while, he decided he wanted to come back home.
Why he returned is another debatable topic. And this is where Oswald's story gets muddy. By piecing together different facts and connecting him with people who do seem to appear in his life, one could conclude that Oswald could be either a government agent or a foreign operative. Researcher Philip Melanson says actions by the governments of both the United States and the Soviet Union indicate that indeed Oswald had significant intelligence connections.
We know there was a program in place to palm off some of our defectors as spies, just as the Russians were doing that to us. And I'm sure that they had suspicions about Oswald. That is why they didn't take him right away. But eventually he was able to convince them with a little dramatics of his alleged suicide attempt, which may have been nothing more than a ploy to be accepted. And we also would have had to figure out when Oswald was coming back to us whether or not he was a Soviet agent, because they might have turned him around. And the ease with which government let him go over there, even though he might have had U-2 secrets, the laxity with which they lent him the money to come back and allegedly never debriefed him, and then the unconcern or disregard we seem to have for his ostensible pro-Castro activities would simply lead one to the conclusion that either government was completely incompetent at all phases of Oswald's dealings and defections and passports and activities, or that he was accounted for as some kind of agent.
Then there were Oswald's possible connections with Cuba. He was working with an organization called the Fair Play for Cuba Committee, an organization he developed in New Orleans, and which had a membership of one, Oswald.
We advocate restoration of diplomatic, trade, and tourist relations with Cuba.
He had gone public on the radio in support of the Cuban Revolution. But the theorists who claim he was an agent also say his role with the Fair Play Committee was a ruse, that he wanted to make it look as though he was a Cuban sympathizer, so that later, when he killed the president, the investigators would be thrown off the track. It's easy to imagine why forces inside Cuba would want the president killed. First, there was the Bay of Pigs, then the Cuban Missile Crisis.
Castro and his fellow dictators may rule nations, they do not rule people. They may imprison bodies, but they do not imprison spirits. They may destroy the exercise of liberty, but they cannot eliminate the determination to be free.
And don't forget that in 1975, the United States government admitted that in the early 60s, it had made 8 separate attempts to kill Fidel Castro. Research has uncovered many bizarre assassination plots against the Cuban leader by the CIA, and it's known that Kennedy knew nothing about them at the time. When he did become informed, he stopped them at once and attempted to reconcile the two countries' differences. But even so, there are those who say Castro had to be involved. And Henry Hurt, author of the best-selling book Reasonable Doubt, says,
whether Castro had a hand in it or not, we know that the moment Lyndon Johnson became president, Castro's problems were over. Lyndon Johnson never paid any attention to Cuba. Lyndon Johnson was fascinated with winning a war on the other side of the world. Thus, we launched into Vietnam, but Castro's problems stopped the second Kennedy died.
Still others suspect a different scenario, a strange marriage, if you will, between Cuban nationals and American mobsters. But some history is needed here. When the Castro government took control of Cuba, the mob presented it with a loan. Castro spent the money on a fleet of aircraft. The loan was not without strings. The mob had extensive gambling holdings in Cuba, and it wanted them protected. But Castro did the unforgivable. He took the businesses away from the mob and kicked them out of his country. The mob did not consider this fair. Mob figure Meyer Lansky allegedly ordered a $1 million contract on Castro, and other mob attempts against the Cuban leader were launched. Then in 1959, Castro announced that he had become a communist.
I can assure you that this flag will be returned to this brigade in a free Havana.
It is at that point that the United States joined the mob in its desire to get rid of Castro. Dan Moldea says that, unknown to the president, the Central Intelligence Agency joined forces with the mob in working to kill Castro. Say the least, it was a case of strange bedfellows. Jimmy Hoffa was selected as the liaison between the CIA and the mafia. And from here, the story does not get less complicated. Because at the time the CIA was trying to assassinate Castro, Kennedy and his brother Robert, the Attorney General, were involved in a campaign to rid the nation of organized crime. Simply put, one hand of the government was working with organized crime while the other was trying to stamp it out.
Back to this, a strike-breaking, union-busting bill.
Mr. Hoffa, this bill is not a strike-breaking, union-busting bill. You're the best argument I know for it. Your testimony here this afternoon, your complete indifference to the fact that numerous people who hold responsible positions in your union come before this committee and take the Fifth Amendment because an honest answer might tend to incriminate them.
John and Bob Kennedy got down to business about dealing with what Bob Kennedy would call the enemy within, the threat of the mafia and organized crime against American society. And they put together a hit list. Number one on the hit list was Jimmy Hoffa. Number two was Carlos Marcello, the mafia boss from New Orleans. Number three was Santos Traficani, the mafia boss from Florida. And Sam Giancana and Johnny Roselli. Now, unknown to Robert and John Kennedy at the time, several of these people were involved in this CIA mafia plot to murder Fidel Castro.
A moment ago, we mentioned strange bedfellows. Much has been made of John Kennedy's affair with a woman named Judith Campbell. Campbell was no society lady. Moldea tells us that Campbell was also mobster Sam Giancana's mistress. Giancana planted Campbell on Kennedy in order to smear him and get him to back off the organized crime investigation. It didn't work. Instead of backing down, John and Robert Kennedy intensified the war. At a mob chieftain's meeting, Jimmy Hoffa suggested that the Attorney General be killed.
While leaving the hearings after these people had testified regarding this matter, did you say that SOB, I'll break his back?
Who?
You.
Say to who?
To anyone. Did you make that statement after these people testified before the committee?
I never talked to either one of them to testify.
Now, I'm not talking about to them. Did you make that statement here in the hearing room after the testimony was finished?
Not concerning them, far as I know of.
Well, who did you make it about?
I don't know. I may have been discussing somebody in the figure of speech.
Well, who did you make the statement? Whose back were you going to break?
I don't even remember it.
Well, whose back were you going to break, Mr. Hoffa?
Figure of speech, I don't even know who I was talking about, and I don't know what you're talking about.
But New Orleans mob boss Carlos Marcello did not agree.
Marcello had said during this meeting that, you know, Bobby Kennedy was driving him crazy, but if they kill Bobby Kennedy, as Hoffa wants to do, it's, you know, they're going to appoint a crazy person as attorney general, and he's going to come at them with everything they have. Plus, if Bobby Kennedy died suddenly and violently, everyone's going to know in 5 seconds who did it. They're going to look right at the mafia and its Teamsters Union. So Marcello announced, if you want to kill the snake, you cut off his head. And what that meant was, if you want to kill Bob Kennedy, you kill his brother, because John Kennedy is the person who controls Bob Kennedy.
Muldea concludes that the evidence of a mafia connection to the murder of John Kennedy is overwhelming. He says there's no doubt that the assassination was a straight mob hit. Muldea concludes that the evidence of a mafia connection to the murder of John Kennedy is overwhelming. He says there's no doubt that the assassination was a straight mob hit. As we're learning, no conclusion in the assassination investigation goes unchallenged. Professor David Rohn says it makes no sense for the mafia to try to kill the president, because what if they missed?
They had the means, perhaps. Yes, they had the means. They had an opportunity. Did they really have a motive? How long would Kennedy stay in power? 8 years at most. And you weather those sort of things. What's more important to the mob is to continue rather than to exterminate itself. If they had failed in their attempt to shoot John Kennedy, then God help them, right? They would then rip to shreds. How do they know they wouldn't be caught? So it's better to keep, if you have $10 billion, it's better to keep $5 billion of them than to lose it all.
But there are still troubling connections to organized crime that cannot be ignored. Jack Ruby is the most obvious.
The suspect's name is Jack Rubenstein, I believe. He goes by the name of Jack Ruby.
The man who shot Oswald on national television was not then, but is now, known to have been connected with the mob. His telephone records in the days and weeks before the assassination indicate that he had been talking to several top officials in the Teamsters Union and to a mob enforcer in Chicago. Former President Gerald Ford was a member of the Warren Commission that investigated the assassination. He thought that Ruby was simply an odd person who overreacted.
No question, Jack Ruby was an odd, eccentric individual. An individual who was very emotionally attached to the Kennedy family, etc. I was present with the Chief Justice at the time we interrogated Jack Ruby, and I can tell you from my own experience in that interrogation that Jack Ruby was the kind of a person who could, and obviously did, take dramatic action. I don't recall offhand the allegations of him being part of or having association with criminal elements, but I can tell you from my own presence at the interrogation of Ruby that it was very possible that somebody that emotionally unstable could have done on the spur of the moment what he did do.
25 years later, Ford believes Ruby's claim to have had a deep affection for the Kennedy family and to have killed Oswald to protect Jackie Kennedy from the horror of a trial in Dallas. To others, that's simply a smokescreen.
Do you have anything to say in your defense? Oswald has been shot.
In a moment, a further investigation of mob involvement. This is the PIA Radio Network. I'm Edwin Newman. A moment ago, we heard how former President Gerald Ford, a member of the Warren Commission, does not believe that Jack Ruby was connected to the underworld.
He told me that really the first thing that he remembered of the shooting itself was when he was in the homicide office after the shooting, and he says they were shouting, and someone was shouting at him, "You shot Oswald. Why did you shoot Oswald?" And that's really the first recollection he has of it. I would think that we would at least plead temporary insanity.
Further, Ford maintains that the mob was not involved in the assassination. But a more recent study done on the case suggests again that there was organized criminal involvement. Dr. David Schein has recently published a book entitled Contract on America, a discussion of criminal influence in the assassination. Schein, along with 7 Harvard students, studied the assassination and came to a simple conclusion.
That the mafia killed President Kennedy, and in particular that Carlos Marcello, the mafia boss of New Orleans, was a central figure in this conspiracy.
And his investigations found that the same name kept popping up, Carlos Marcello, the New Orleans crime boss.
Marcello's fingerprints are all over the case. We look at Ruby's phone records. He's calling and visiting many associates of Carlos Marcello. Oswald is in very close contact in 1963 with 2 lieutenants of Marcello, David Ferry and his uncle Dutz Merritt. At least 2, I wouldn't say lieutenants. Oswald was in close contact with 2 associates of Carlos Marcello in 1963.
So the criminal activity traveled all the way from the New Orleans syndicate to Dallas that day by way of Jack Ruby, who ran a strip joint there. Places like his were illegal, but he had help in running the club because he knew just about everyone in the police department.
This is Detective Jim Lavelle, who was this morning handcuffed to Oswald and was bringing him out to the car to be transferred to a county jail. Could you tell us what happened?
You were handcuffed to him?
I was handcuffed to him and also had a hold of the waistband of his trousers. I saw this man come from the crowd, and at the time he emerged from this crowd of people, he was not more than 6 or 7 feet from me.
Did you see the gun in his hand as he came?
I saw the gun in his hand as he emerged from the crowd. But being such a short distance from me, I had no time to say anything.
Did you recognize him when he came through?
Yes, I have known Jack Ruby for a number of years, and I recognized him just as soon as he emerged from the crowd.
Scheim says also that the Dallas police were no strangers to organized crime.
After Ruby shot Oswald, he was put in a Dallas jail cell under the custody of Sheriff Bill Decker. And in fact, Decker wrote a character reference for Joseph Sabillo, the mafia boss of Dallas, who was also a close associate of Ruby. So when Ruby, after his first-degree murder conviction, requested to testify before the Warren Commission and then told the commission, "My life is in danger in Dallas. I can't tell the truth in Dallas. I want to go to Washington to testify," Ruby had very strong grounds for his fear and for wanting to be transferred to another place.
The only thing I can say, what is your name, and I'll know how to address
Harry Kennedy.
Harry Kennedy. Everything pertaining to what's happening has never come to the surface. The world will never know the true facts of what occurred, my motives. In other words, I'm the only person in the background that knows the truth pertaining to everything relating to my circumstances.
Do you think it'll ever come out?
No, because unfortunately, the people that have so much to gain and have such an material motive for putting me in a position I'm in will will never let the true fact come of their voice to the world.
Now, these people are in very high positions, Jack.
Yes.
When Ruby talked to the Warren Commission, he tried to tip them off to the mob connection, according to Shine. Testimony that must have been ignored, because...
In Ruby's testimony, one of the amazing statements he makes, and I'm quoting virtually verbatim, if the murder of Oswald was timed so perfectly by seconds, then someone in the police department is guilty of giving the information as to when Oswald was coming down.
So, how could the Warren Commission ignore these claims? Scheim says the answer is simple. There were orders from above.
This is a very, you know, complex question that I think, you know, it's clear that there was a conspiracy. The Senate Intelligence Committee reviewed the case and found that both Hoover and Johnson had written memos stating the public must be satisfied that Oswald was the lone assassin. And further, the memo stated that speculation about conspiracy should be cut off. It's clear that, you know, the government, and in particular J. Edgar Hoover and Lyndon Johnson, wanted a very quick and superficial conclusion to the investigation.
But why change the focus of the investigation from one of trying to find the truth to one of placating the public? Because, it's theorized, if the truth were to come out at that time, the public would know how they had been lied to for years by their own government's chief law enforcement body, the FBI.
Hoover, for years, refused to admit that the mafia existed. In fact, in 1957, when some of his agents reported on a major mafia conclave, Hoover had the reports rescinded and had the agents demoted. Hoover put an organized crime commission out of business at one point, and there's a report by Arthur Schlesinger citing two sources that Hoover met with Frank Costello in New York's Central Park on a couple of occasions. So it appears that Hoover, like certain people in the CIA, felt that the mafia was a convenient tool, you know, to do the government's bidding, and was not all that keen on exposing them.
Investigator Sylvia Marr agrees that the FBI, for reasons unknown, made a full investigation of the assassination impossible.
The FBI did a very poor job, but worse than that, the FBI actually went so far as to conceal and destroy evidence, to destroy evidence and conceal it from the Warren Commission.
The memorandum and the note in question, and he handed it to me, and he said, in effect, Oswald's dead now, there can be no trial. Here, get rid of this. I then proceeded to tear it up. His presence, he said, no, get it out of here. I don't even want it in this office. Get rid of it. I then took it out and destroyed it.
And how did you destroy it?
I took it into the washroom and flushed it down the drain.
Well, how many agents in the Dallas field office knew about it?
I understand about 30.
About 30. How many in the Washington field office and headquarters?
To my knowledge, none.
Well, wasn't Mr. Shanklin on the telephone a lot with J. Edgar Hoover?
He was on the telephone to FBI headquarters. I don't know specifically who he was talking to.
Were he and Mr. Hoover rather close?
Well, for Mr. Hoover, and he reported to him.
The CIA also concealed evidence of the highest importance from the Warren Commission. That is to say, its plots to assassinate Fidel Castro, which only came to light in about 1975. And so it was relying on agencies which were dishonest, unprofessional, and to some degree, incompetent.
Investigator Harold Weisberg has written 5 volumes on the assassination, and he thinks one reason the crime has not been solved lies at the feet of J. Edgar Hoover and the FBI. He claims that they've not ever really investigated the assassination. But his theory is not that the FBI knew that the mob was involved, but that they were simply caught flat-footed.
They never investigated the crime and never intended to. Yes, they were covering their own ass. Remember I said earlier, the first laws cover the bureaus and the second laws cover your own. It happened. Here was this greatest investigator of all time, Hoover, who didn't prevent it from happening. And worst of all, he didn't know what the hell had happened. So he had to take control. Control is the name of the FBI's game in cases like this. Don't misunderstand me. They can do magnificent work. I'm not saying they don't. I'm certainly not saying they can't, because they can and they do. I've seen them do it. But this is something that would not be acceptable in the jerk water 100 miles from a railroad station.
Another view of the FBI role in the investigation follows that line of thinking. Author Henry Hertz says the shoddy investigation by the FBI was done to protect Hoover's ego. Hoover was hoping, Hertz believes, to solve the crime quickly, to vindicate himself.
As soon as the shots rang out, as soon as we knew Kennedy was dead, J. Edgar Hoover wanted the case solved within minutes. So it was the supreme test of his career. After all, solving cases is what he was all about. And so I think that there was an overwhelming pressure instantly to solve the case. And if you were down the line in the FBI in those years, and I think there's ample evidence of this, you didn't want to be calling up Mr. Hoover and for days on end saying, "We don't know." And so within 24 hours, Hoover had seen enough evidence suggesting that Oswald did it to make him commit himself. And once he committed himself, the die was cast. From that moment on, there was no turning back. We know enough about Hoover's character to know that there was no one in the bureau that could go in and say, Mr. Hoover, you're wrong. Mr. Hoover, I was wrong. Mr. Hoover, we were all wrong. That's absolutely incomprehensible to suggest that anybody could have done that. So no matter how powerful the evidence became suggesting that other leads should be pursued, nobody in the bureau did it.
To that end, several documents disappeared and some evidence was apparently altered, which kept the Warren Commission from discovering the whole truth. In a moment, we'll look at the government's investigation of the assassination, an investigation that critics say was marred by everything from sloppy work to cover-up. We'll be back with the JFK conflict on the PIA Radio Network after this. This is the PIA Radio Network. I'm Edwin Newman. 25 years ago, President John F. Kennedy was assassinated in Dallas, Texas. Since then, questions have been raised about who killed the president and why. For the most part, those questions have gone unanswered. After the assassination, the government did what governments often do, form a commission to study the event and report on what went wrong. The commission, named for its chairman, Chief Justice Earl Warren, has been criticized perhaps more than any other commission in American history. Charges range from a sloppy job of investigating to a cover-up for incompetence to hiding a governmental murder. Former President Gerald Ford served on the commission and was present for more testimony than any other member. He says that after all these years and all the investigations, he still stands by the report.
As a member of the Warren Commission, I fully support the basic recommendations of the commission, which were submitted to President Johnson and to the American people in 1964. And the conclusions of the commission then are just as valid, if not more so today, than they were at the time the report was finalized.
Sylvia Marr painstakingly read every page of the 26 volumes of the Warren Commission hearings and exhibits. She thoroughly checked cross-references and created an index for the volumes. When she was finished, she was not pleased with what she had learned.
I had to conclude that the report was a very contaminated document which did not deserve any credence, that the commission had virtually framed Oswald by disregarding all evidence that tended to be exculpatory, and even more flagrantly, by disregarding all evidence of conspiracy, and sticking to its insistent conclusion that Oswald and Oswald alone had committed this heinous crime.
That's a lot to say, but Marr says she stands behind it with proof. It comes in what appear to be insignificant facts that have been twisted or have been overlooked in the investigation. But she says they are not tiny points when you look into them.
In fact, the commission went so far as to invent wholly false claims about the evidence. For example, the commission said that Oswald had traveled from London to Helsinki by air and had left London Airport on October the 9th. But in the 26 volumes, I found his passport, and it was stamped, left London by air, October the 10th. Now, that may seem very insignificant, but it was a whopping lie, because on October the 10th, there was no commercial flight that would have brought Oswald to Helsinki at the time he arrived and checked into a hotel there. And the point of this is that when you know that he actually left on the 10th and not on the 9th, as the commission claimed, you are bound to begin to suspect that he flew to Helsinki in some highly unconventional way, possibly on an official plane of some kind, a CIA plane, a government plane. In any case, the commission simply falsified the facts.
There were other points the commission seemed either to miss or to change to fit its preconceived notion of what happened. The one that gets the most attention is the so-called magic bullet. Robert Sam Anson.
Much of the criticism focused on what occurred in Dealey Plaza, specifically the condition of Commission Exhibit 399, the so-called magic bullet, that according to the Warrant Commission had struck President Kennedy in the back, passed through his neck, exited, made a 90-degree right-hand turn, went 6 inches, and apparently saw John Connally, the then governor of Texas, made a 90-degree left-hand turn, entered Governor Connally's body, and it was one shot, 7 wounds, and the bullet emerged remarkably, miraculously intact. That was one of the things that the critics of the Warren Commission focused on, and the fact that the FBI, which conducted numerous tests trying to replicate the condition of the so-called magic bullet,